Hey Rockstars, how's it going? Today I'm finally going to be doing my major June 2020 Kickstarter video. That means talking about exciting games launching, about all the ones ending, about the late pledges, and then finally ending on the news. So strap in, buckle up, tie it down, secure it, or do whatever you need to do to get ready for a wave of information. Let's get to it. As always, I want to give a huge shout out to all of my patrons and YouTube members. Thank you so much for your support, which enables me to be free and independent. I make the videos I want to make and say what I want to say, and that means a lot less support from the companies I am supposed to be critical of. I never accept money from them, and you guys are at the center of ensuring I can continue to do that while also publishing as many videos I do at the quality that they are. And to all of you watching that tend to like, comment, subscribe, follow that Amazon link, purchase any merch, or pause that ad blocker, thank you from the bottom of my heart. Your actions truly do make a difference, and I'm incredibly lucky to be in a community with such awesome people such as yourselves. And you know what? Even if you don't do any of that, I'm happy to have you here, and I hope you find this video helpful. You guys are all rock stars. With that out of the way, we'll be starting things out with the campaigns launching in June. What makes June a big month is just everything already going on, but there are still some campaigns launching that I know about that are worth mentioning. As a reminder, before I get into the games, there are a ton of links down in the description below for many of the games in this video, so feel free to use those as needed. Starting things out is Terraforming Mars Big Box by Stronghold Games on June 9th. The big things here are the 3D tiles, card dividers, 3 brand new tiles, unique global parameter markers, and room to hold the first player rover. Then we have Dinosaur 1944 by Peterson Games on June 15th. It's a pretty self-explanatory game. There's dinosaurs and it's World War II put into a blender. We don't know much about the gameplay yet, but the renders they are showing off look quite nice. Next up is Hybris Disordered Cosmos by Aurora Game Studio, which will be launching on Kickstarter on June 30th. It's a 1-4 player worker placement game with some Ameritrash thrown in for good measure. In the game, you take control of an Olympian god in their early years while they are still figuring out a hierarchy. As such, it is your job to try and get to the top. You'll be trying to gain prayers, accomplishing quests, fighting heroes, upgrading technology and divinity, and unlocking enhancements to try and claim victory after 6 ages. Each god plays differently and is good at different things, and the miniature design looks very unique. You might see this on the channel this month. If it's something you'd like to see, please be sure to let me know. Okay, incidentally, that's it for the campaigns with solid dates. The rest I can't find a verifiable source on for the dates, but I estimate them to launch in June or close to it. Core Clash is a 2-4 player team skirmish game where you take on mechs and fight each other to the death on a map with 3D terrain. I pretty much like every word I just said. There are several types of dice, and really everything looks cool except for the art. The box art in particular is so muddled I can't tell what's going on at all with it. Otherwise, I'm totally interested. Domination is another 2-4 player game taking place in World War II. You get tiny little boats and tanks and stuff. It's a 2.0 version of mini World War II that came out before with lots of fixes and changes to make the game better. Sadly, in an attempt to stay historically accurate, you can't play as America right away, and in fact, they have the United Kingdom player controlling America. Oh gosh, I think it just threw up in my mouth. All kidding aside, I fully support any games that take feedback and improve upon it, so I hope they are successful with it. Castle Panic Deluxe is still set to come out at some point. Finally, we have Batman RPG by Monolith. No word yet on what will be included or exactly when this is coming, but I'd expect late June-ish or perhaps a bit later. My hope here is that they also provide terrain-style miniatures. I already have a ton of the characters, but having objectives and such as miniatures would be a big step in getting me to back this. Besides, didn't they tease 3D versions of their maps at some point? Okay, now for the campaigns ending in June. Warning, there are a ton of them. Classic Quest will be ending in a little over a week. It's a very indie take on something akin to perhaps HeroQuest, but as they say, the best thing about HeroQuest is the art on the box. This game lacks that, so it pales in comparison. In all honesty, while it's funded, it's been struggling. I've not dived into why, but I suspect the root of the issue is just how indie of an effort it seems to be, coupled by very lackluster stretch goals. Next up is Ulea Chronicles, which is ending in just a few short days. Again, I don't know much about the game itself, and it seems quite indie. However, this one seems to have some pretty well-designed miniatures, actually. Also, you get to fight dinosaurs and play as a gorilla man, so there's that. Now, you guys didn't think I'd go on and forget about Nemesis Lockdown, did you? With most of June still to go before it ends, it's already racked up millions in funding. The fact that at this time of recording, it's pretty close to the original backer count shows how many are choosing to return for more, which says a lot about how well loved the game is. While it wasn't for me, as I found it far too random and reactive in nature, plenty others adore it. Lockdown is a standalone expansion to Nemesis, though you can still pledge to receive everything from the first campaign as well. Now, I'm actually not overly fond of standalone expansions for any game, as it always means owners of the first are paying for stuff they already have thanks to the shared components. On the positive side, you get to play as a janitor as you fight in a new alien race on a Mars outpost, so that's cool. Awakened Realms is doing daily unlocks, which I think is awesome, and fully support. Come On launched Come On Comics Volume 1, and it's a very short campaign, so is ending in less than a week. They too are doing daily unlocks, which look for the most part to be more heroes. They also added an add-on for $20 to get you a Starcadia Quest comic that's about half the length of the others, plus some Kickstarter exclusives. As I said in my previous video, I don't support the tendencies to attach gameplay exclusives for games and products that are this far removed, in this case, attached with the purchase of something outside of a board game. While Come On's deal here is nothing terrible, and I actually love that they're expanding on their IPs and also love comics, I don't like adding the miniatures behind the purchase of the comics, simply because I like to shy away from that tendency. That being said, daily unlocks are great, and if you want more heroes, like we don't have enough already, this is something to look into. Kemet Blood and Sand is doing pretty well. Thanks to an early goal, all of the miniatures will be 20% larger, and they are busy unlocking stretch goals like the double-layer player boards. While I think the miniatures look rather meh, and there are a lot of repeats, it's a well-reviewed game supposedly just made better, so a safer bet gameplay-wise than many other options. Next up we have Euthia Torment of Resurrection, which is in its final days. It actually hit a snag and was losing money in the middle of the campaign, but has turned itself around and has actually gained quite a bit more. This was done by adding several add-ons and a new legendary pledge with a steep discount. It actually looks quite nice. At $159, you're getting fancy parts like metal coins and sleeves, which are items often not included and are more expensive as add-ons. Oh, and they also added a dwarf, so that instantly made it better. Oko Oni Hunters is doing modestly well. With a little over a week to go, it's already gotten more backers than their previous card game, so that's good. If you're looking for a co-op card game for two players, this is probably one to really look into. Sea of Legends has just a few days left on Kickstarter, and for a company that only had a single other game for about 400 people before this, has been doing very well. While I don't support it because it requires a phone app to play, it has a unique art style I really appreciate, and pirates, which are always cool. Speaking of pirates, Tiny Epic Pirates has a bit over a week to go still on Kickstarter and is doing quite well, already being one of the best funded in the Tiny Epic series. If you're looking for a light game you can pick up and play that's still heavier than anything else in its weight class, I recommend these games. While nothing like my love for a 55-pound monstrosity of a game, these are actually pretty decent. Then we have Sheol by Lunar Oak Studios, which has a bit over a week to go before the campaign wraps up. This one has been struggling, which is rather unfortunate. It's quite different than most anything else out there, and while not perfect, it's still perfectly fine. They've been adding some add-ons to raise some funds, but new backers haven't been coming too much. They did add a pretty sweet Mind Blower miniature stretch goal, but it's unclear how it'll be unlocked, sadly. In my personal opinion, they should have not put the funding goal so high, and should have unlocked stuff like linen cards the same as everyone else. Besides, most companies make more money during the pledge manager as people add more add-ons and late backers pledge, so putting the amount you need before the pledge manager is actually already rather inaccurate. Either way, hopefully they can turn this thing around. Frey, Champions of the Everyverse by Brain Sandwich Games is turning out to be much the same, sadly. Not only did it have a pretty low first day funding, but it dropped off more than usual ever since. While I didn't look too much into the gameplay, the concept of heroes from all over time fighting each other is an idea I like, and the miniature design actually seems quite nice. They have 26 more days in the campaign, so there is still plenty of time to gain more traction, so hopefully they can get that going. Game Envy has their Desk Wizards campaign going on right now. This is actually an upgrade from their already available paint holders for 1, 3, or 5 paints. Now they support 10 and 14. Hold multiple brushes and have a place to put your phone or tablet. Oh, and they also have lots of colors. I actually might grab a 14 one, since that covers most of my painting efforts, and I like the idea of having all the paints I plan to use on a miniature out, so I don't have to go searching for them. And now it's time for everybody's favorite laundry list, the late pledges. You can still late pledge Arkis, Battletech, Clan Invasion, Chronicle X, Valor and Villainy, Waste Knights, 2nd Edition, the Issafarian Guard, Zervia, Vorpal Board, Storm Sunder, Tenaris Adventures, Frosthaven, Wolfenstein the Board Game, Final Girl. And now for a boatload of news. I hope you are ready for a lot of updates. I'm expanding this news section. It'll now cover more games and deeper details, so expect everything from Kingdom Death Monster updates to delivery updates. I'd like to start out by going over some recently funded campaigns. Adventures in Neverland did quite well, racking up over 500,000 euros from almost 5,000 backers. This is by far Black Box Adventures' largest Kickstarter campaign yet. Ankh, Gods of Egypt did pretty well for itself at $3.3 million raised from over 23,000 backers. For comparison's sake, Rising Sun raised $4.2 million from over 31,000 backers. Mythic Games can breathe a sigh of relief. Hell, the Last Saga funded very well for them at $2.2 million raised from 17.7 thousand backers. Also, to sneak in a short update here, I spoke about my caution around their printed material and that I'd wait to see how Solomon Kane arrived, and I'm happy to report that after much begging and probably some annoyance, we've managed to talk them into adding an index for Solomon Kane. Consumers everywhere can rejoice. That's a good first step in the right direction, and I'm happy to see it. Overbattle successfully funded, which is great to see. Broken Toad's largest campaign to date, Jim Henson's Labyrinth and the Dark Crystal miniature set funded well. They ended up adding quite a few additional options, and I suspect they'll raise quite a bit more in the pledge manager. Obsidia also funded, which is awesome to see. On a personal note, I wanted to thank everyone who mentioned how I helped them find the game a whole lot. You have no idea how rewarding it is for me to find out that I helped bring to light a game that you are excited about and you wouldn't have known about otherwise. You guys truly are rock stars. I actually ended up back in the game as well. Not all of my player group will be interested in it, but enough will to warrant the purchase, and man, does that art look cool. Final Girl not only funded, but became the most funded solo-only board game ever on Kickstarter, so that's fantastic and well-earned, I feel. Of course, Life loves its blemishes. I found out that they have a Kickstarter-exclusive mystery box available for $10. Now, fair warning, this is going to be a short rant. This is really dumb. If it was something worth getting and desirable for $10, they'd show what it is. But instead, they prey on FOMO like a mini version of Come On. They won't tell you what you are buying, but are more than happy to tell you that by the time you find out what the stupid little item is that you bought, it'll be too late and you can't have it. So you will quite literally be fearful of missing out on the item that's not good enough to sell itself, so they hope you'll back it anyway. Screw that up, down, and sideways, and shame on AJ Porfirio for ruining a good-looking campaign with a greedy and manipulative tactic like this. Your game sold well because you showed how awesome it is and people wanted it. If you don't have something to show off, then don't try and sell it. Hey, you gotta admit, this is pretty far in the video before the rant started, so give me some credit. Okay, moving on to some general news. Limbo Eternal War is now delivering to the EU and UK. I believe it's still on the way to other places like Australia, but it's been great to see new people take pictures and get excited about the amazing quality of the miniatures. Dawn of Madness will close its pledge manager on May 31st, so if you've been holding out, then now is the time to take a look at it before making that final decision. I actually ended up doing this as well and backing it after all, as I want to do a final review on it now that they are making so many changes to it, as I think that's only fair. Plus, OMG, have you seen their production miniatures? Man, this is going right up there with Limbo and Hate as my top of the top go-tos for miniature quality and design. In perfect timing for Nemesis Lockdown to launch, Awakened Realms has provided their final development update for Etherfields and shown off a ton of the game in it, which is awesome. If I were to rate their miniatures, I'd give them an overall score of good. Some are great, others okay, so I'll average it to good. As always, when Easter is manufacturing a game, I have some issues with some of the miniatures, while others I think came out gorgeous. Mold lines can be a bit heavy, and every human seems to continue to suffer from cupped or mitten hand syndrome, and there are a few miniatures that obviously don't match their textured base well. But then others were extremely well designed, and the detail level is generally really good, with only a few problem spots. All in all, I'm happy I pledged for the all-in, as these are really unique miniatures. Once it arrives, I imagine I'll have a 2-hour unboxing video of it. La Boite de Joux showed off some new looks into some of the miniatures for their long upcoming game, Daimyo Rebirth of the Empire. As is expected based on their work with Clash of Rage, the miniatures look quite good. Thanks to your overwhelmingly positive reaction to my coverage of Senkokushin 5 Sacrifices, I can guarantee you now that you'll be seeing real pieces of the game on my channel very soon, so excited to show it off more for you all. Now, I failed to cover this before as I didn't know about it, but Tales of Terror can be late pledged. It's a 5e grimdark campaign with lots of cool designed miniatures, heck, even the table mimic is cool. Ludus Magnus Studio posted another update after the first one where they asked for $15 to send you your Wave 2 material, or else wait months later for it. In it, they never once apologize or say sorry for coming to their backers for more money, which in my book isn't owning up to being most of the problem. They do mention COVID twice though, for good measure. Anyway, they claim you will for sure get your Wave 2 if you don't pay, but they'll have to send it as their profits allow. This is misleading as it can't guarantee those profits. We'll have to see how their next campaign turns out for them, but I can't imagine this is great advertising for them. Speaking of which, here's their next campaign preview page. This is the new and improved version of the original game, so a 1.5 really, though I'm unsure if there will be an upgrade pack for original backers or not. Personally, and I say this just because I care about you guys, just keep in mind their financial situation and their other still to be fulfilled campaigns when looking at this one. Know what you're going in before you do it. Joining Ludus Magnus Studio in great company is none other than Steamforged Games, the only other company that I can tell that is delivering at this time and also charging consumers for it. Surprisingly, the company behind one of the legendary all-time worst fulfillment stories with Dark Souls handled the actual communication about charging more for shipping much better than Ludus Magnus Studios did. Most of that is due to their situation actually being better than LMS's. Steamforged Games is just using COVID to cover more delays from November to July, so an 8-month delay, and then charging for people to get the core game still at the November timeframe. They didn't come out and say they just simply can't afford to ship the product, just introducing a late game second wave shipping option. Okay, the rest is good news, I promise. Come On announced Masters of the Universe, the board game. It will be available only for North America, South America, and Asia, and will have miniatures. Developed by Michael and Leo, who also did Bloodborne and A Song of Ice and Fire, this should actually do quite well. Personally, I think it'd just be neat to paint in all the fun colors. We'll see more of this when it launches on Kickstarter in 2021. Kingdom Death Monster showed off some interesting things. First, right off the bat, I want to say how much I love the character from the Bizzle Woods campaign that they showed off. The fairy tale take on it with super dynamic facial expressions and insinuated motion is just awesome. To be honest, this miniature alone will have me look into possibly getting that expansion. Also, I forgot to mention this, but Kingdom Death Monster is getting what they call a showdown tracker. This is pretty much KDM Lite in virtual form. You can do stuff like chat, roll dice, move the miniatures around, it has a white line and starting survivors, etc. It's in super alpha stage, but it's free if you own Kingdom Death Monster, so that's great, and I'm excited to see where it eventually goes. Modiphius continues to expand their Fallout Wasteland Warfare line in new directions. They released even more STLs for 3D printing terrain and also announced the desire to make a Tabletopia and or a tabletop simulator version of the game, which is just great. Archon Studios' latest update for Wolfenstein actually included a very cool video where you see some of the people behind the company, their work area, and also their production area where you get to see some of their steel molds and plastic trays of minis and such. Similar to the Kingdom Death Monster story, Vorpal Board, thanks in part to the COVID issues many are facing, has released a beta version of their software for both Android and iOS, which is great to see. I actually backed this to better play games with my patrons, as I play prototypes with them from time to time, so that's cool to see it progress and become more readily available. Finally, we're at the end, and so now I present to you the dragon from Primal the Awakening. This 140mm boss monster looks nice and ferocious. I actually really dig his horn design. Long tongue, and I feel the runes on the rocks on the base are a very nice touch, as are the holes in his wings. I will actually be telling you more about the gameplay itself in a future Kickstarter video this month, so be on the lookout for that. Okay, whew! That's it. That's everything, guys. I put in hours of work into this one, reading a ton of updates, comments, news articles, and more. Wrote this very script and edited the video, all so that you guys can be better informed consumers, so I sincerely hope that work pays off and this video helped you in some way. Now, I'm gonna go get a drink of water and catch my breath. You guys keep on rocking.